say a few words first. See that you unplugged the microphone. I think from what I've seen today, I think it's helpful to keep everything together, because one discipline is deeply related with another. I've never met any of the other speakers before, but I was able to identify with many of the things they were saying, many of their concepts, and I think they improve and enhance my concepts and my ideas.
So, following on from that, I think what we need fundamentally is an interdisciplinary approach, and weirdly enough, that's not happening enough in universities. You know, the guys from computer science aren't talking to the guys in theatre, and the guys in theatre aren't talking to the guys in biology and chemistry. And you know, so it's kind of a human thing, we're all in this together. And weirdly enough, the UK is probably, from an arts perspective, the UK is probably one of the best places at the moment to actually look at this and funding sort of projects like this. If you look at FACT in Liverpool and what they're doing, they've got something coming up soon, which I think is Future Plus, which is a conference and arts event, and there's, you know, places, Human Plus is an exhibition that's happening in Belfast soon. So there's been plenty of art science collaboration, but it requires an interdisciplinary approach. It can't happen otherwise. It's going to go off in one group. You know, we need to look at this together. If it's a human thing we're looking at, we're going to make that sound. So you kind of okay.
Yes. Yes, Dean, my answer to this is things will emerge, and the more connections we are, and the more open we are, and the more we remove the restrictions, things will emerge which we have not predicted. And my best example of a scientist, I think, is someone like Mendel, Johann Mendel, who was a priest, and he designed essentially the whole idea of genetics, because he observed these pea plants which had certain characteristics over generations. So to me, the more you bring these different groups of people together, the more you remove barriers. Same thing I talked about in telecourses, as many of you know. This will benefit new emerging things which we don't predict.
Question
there.
Does the panel think that telepathy might be a part of human evolution?
What?
Anyone else?
One of the key Buddhist teachings is to use meditation to prepare for death. How would the concept of not dying or delaying death almost indefinitely negate that particular meditation?
So, a question from Aris. Do you think that, or do you anticipate any specific technologies that will allow robust human rejuvenation and extend our lifespan greatly? For example, do you think it could all be done with advanced stem cell technology to rejuvenate our organs, or do you think we'd have to go out further and wait for really advanced nanotech for that to happen?
That last one's a good question, but Aubrey de Grey will be speaking second after lunch, so he'll have something to add to whatever Mario says on that front.
Just to answer your question. No, I anticipate that technology will help. I'm heavily dependent upon synthetic biology developments that would interfere with the DNA. Nanotechnology might help, but one of the areas of my research is how synthetic biology can change DNA, particularly with certain parts of the DNA, the transposons, which are parts of the DNA that are currently silent, that can be activated and have been activated, like the Sleeping Beauty transposon. And this can change genes, can change the way genes produce factors and molecules. And we've further studied this particular subject, synthetic biology and transposons. I think we'll come up with new things that nobody has thought of before. And about, you said, meditation and death. Yeah.
That's a question for people who advocate Buddhism, I guess.
Yes, the Tibetan book of Dylan has that one. Okay, I think I can answer that. I don't exactly have an answer, but I think that's what you were referring to. I think you were referring to the Tibetan book of the living Buddha. There is some usefulness in that, and it depends on the cultural tradition. So my cultural tradition, I'm agnostic of any particular religion, but I obviously come from the background of that kind of thing. I don't have an answer.
Let me chip in with the theologian Niebuhr's answer to that question. His famous saying is, God grant me the serenity to accept what I can't change, to change what I is in my power, and the wisdom to know the difference. So I think that's a very good guide to life. You know, if there's something we really can't accept, we can't change, then we better accept it. But what is now opening up is that some things which we had to accept in the past no longer need to be accepted. We've had lots of childhood diseases throughout the centuries. People had just to accept them in a way, and then a bit of serenity in the midst of that terrible situation wasn't a bad thing. But now that we've got the means to eradicate more of these childhood diseases, of course we're going to do it. So if we have the ability to eradicate all the ravages of death and all the senility and all the pain of dementia and all of that, of course we're going to grab it. There'll be other things we still have to be acquiescent about, and that discipline will still be good in that circumstance.
Have you been any studies done with regards to REM sleep and the report on the brain or regenerative effects?
And yes, do you want to take that question? Was that addressed to Mario or Mario? Thank you.
You mean REM sleep in relation to aging?
Yes. What I was thinking is the brain is sort of stimulating itself then, isn't it? So, you know, instead of being out and doing things to stimulate the, you know, your own mind, and it's, you know, is it doing something, you know, that could be improving itself automatically?
No, I'm not aware of any studies that work through sleep. I mean, it could be a good idea for somebody to study this in relation to aging, in relation to enhancing certain aspects that can affect aging. But there have been studies about the duration of sleep and how sleep can affect aging. Basically, it depends on individuals. The general idea is that up to 6 hours sleep for the average population is a good thing, sometimes 6.5 or so. But if it is longer than that, or if it is shorter than that, then equally causes damage that can affect aging, can accelerate aging. And obviously it depends on the individual. But that's a general approximation.
And thank you.
Yeah, this is a question for Ajit. I was too busy checking my Twitter stream to follow your methodology entirely, but how would you suggest countering the attention deficit nature of social networking to incorporate the mindfulness of meditation?
Okay, that is a fairly long answer to that, but I'm trying to concise as much as possible. To me, if you imagine if you stood on the motorway, yes, and you watch these cars go by, would you think that is a disturbing experience? To most people, it's not. Because if you try to recollect that, if you try to ask them 10 minutes, what cars might pass by, they would not know. Yes, they would not care as well. What would be interesting is if you liked Ferraris, if you liked Mercedes or something like that, and if you observed these cars with the intention of observing how many of them were Mercedes Benz or blue BMW sort of thing, you are immediately attached to the thought stream which is going in front of you. That is the problem. To me, the emotional attachment to the messages is a problem, not the messages themselves. And this is the fundamental, which I didn't touch on this, I must admit, because I was very conscious that I wanted to keep it within a framework of the subject. But that is a short answer to my question. Quite happy to share more with you after, because I'm actually looking for people to review the book and to look at some of my other stuff as well. So this is.
Okay, with that I'd like to thank our panel and